Hello and welcome back to Endless Ocean. Last time we received an email about Japanese bullhead sharks spawning. We're gonna go check that out. Now this is the first time we've had to do something rather special while diving. We can dive with a partner. And we're gonna take Skippy with us. Now diving with a partner has certain benefits in game. Of course, partners are generally cetaceans like Skippy here, and they can do unique things underwater that will be quite useful. Yep, as is, Skippy can ignore our whistle or go do his own thing without paying us much attention. So for right now, let's just go look for those Japanese bullhead sharks. Now you might notice that much of this game involves diving solo, on your own, just exploring the environment, doing your own thing as a single diver. Of course, Catherine's there with her own little camera on her tank, but she's not really there to help us in case something goes wrong. Now, in real life, you would not normally do that while scuba diving. In fact, one of the least safe things you can do is dive alone. Very dangerous. Very, very bad idea. Imagine if you got stuck. Imagine if you all of a sudden started having air troubles or ran out of air earlier than you suspected. What if you had any number of accidents happen to you while underwater? It's not easy to get to the surface, and in fact, climbing quickly to the surface could kill you outright. So having a buddy with you, who you can, say, use the secondary regulator on to get some air, or who can help you out by cutting you free or getting you help or assistance, is quite important. Of course, this is a video game, and having you rely on a second person would be difficult. But you do get the dive buddy in the form of our dolphin friends, which is something, I suppose. And while you're doing guides, you do guide around a second person. Though, really, there's no danger in this game. Now, what's this big area over here? We've just found the Deep Valley. This place is very deep. In fact, it's so deep, we cannot go to the bottom of it. Nope, we cannot go to the bottom. But first, looks like we found a shark. Is it perhaps the shark we're looking for? Let's find out. If he'd be accommodating. There we go. No, it's a zebra shark. Now, you might notice something quite interesting about the zebra shark. It doesn't seem to have any stripes, unlike its name would suggest. Well, there's a good reason for its name, and that's because when zebra sharks are juveniles, they do have stripes. But as they age, these stripes contract and become spots. Quite interesting. Let's see. Ah, another Stark's demoiselle. Now, I just mentioned that we're a bit restricted in where we can go in this area. And it's kind of difficult to talk about that without kind of explaining some of the theory and general understanding of oceanic locales and the depth you can dive to in them. Perhaps it would be good to explain them a bit. It is often easier while discussing oceanic locales to break them up into approximate separate zones. Those zones off the continental shelf are said to be pelagic or oceanic zones, specifically defined by their being non-proximate to the oceanic floor, while those zones on the continental shelf are said to be neritic or coastal zones. These zones are further distinguished by their depth. The epipelagic zone is the outermost oceanic zone and resides within the so-called photic zone of the water. where sufficient sunlight can pass through the water such that photosynthesis can occur. This zone can in open ocean extend down to 200 meters, 650 feet, though the amount of light greatly decreases as one descends. Photosynthetic corals are seldom found in waters deeper than 60 meters, 200 feet, though deep water non-photosynthetic varieties can be found deeper. As one descends, the water also gets increasingly cooler, as the heating the sun provides becomes less and less significant. Below the photic epipelagic zone, you have the aphotic zones. The outermost of these, the mesopelagic zone, is between 200 and 1,000 meters. Here, light is rare, and what light that does pass through is insufficient for any photosynthesis to occur. Here is where we find the thermocline, the thin layer between the turbulent mixed layer of the ocean above and the calm, deep water below. Here is also where we start to find the first quote-unquote deep sea animals. As one travels deeper, you find the bathypelagic zone, the depth of absolute darkness, the abyssopelagic zone, the deepest part of the main ocean, and finally, the deepest of the deep, the hadopelagic zone, the deep sea trenches. The deeper you go, the more unusual life tends to be, as animals have become adapted to the absolute darkness and high pressures. Of course, using scuba, you don't get that deep. Generally speaking, standard dives never go below 40 meters, 130 feet, at least in the recreational realm. Technical divers can go deeper using mixed gas mixtures in their tanks, multiple tanks, and having to stop and decompress at each atmosphere so that nitrogen and other inert gases don't build up in their blood, leading to potentially lethal nitrogen sickness, also known as the bends. Deep dives also have the risk of nitrogen narcosis, or the narcs, the so-called rapture of the deep. As you dive deeper, you essentially get drunk off of the nitrogen oxide often used while diving. One informal reference used for it is the so-called Martini's Law, that the effect of the narcosis is equivalent to one martini for every 10 meters you travel below 20 meters. The deepest scuba dive on record is 330 meters, or 1,000 feet, just barely into the bathypelagic zone. It took him 10 minutes to dive to that depth, but 8 hours and 49 minutes to resurface due to the decompression stops necessary. For reference, the deepest a Navy diver has ever gone in one of the hard atmospheric diving suits was 610 meters, or 2,000 feet. Most of this game takes place on the continental shelf, though, so generally speaking, we won't be going very deep, with one notable exception, but that will come later. So let's see if we can spot some fish we haven't found before. Now there's bound to be something new around here. So what do we have here? Ah yes, the opah. Now, opah are normally found in mesopelagic depths, between 50 and 500 meters, rather much deeper than where we are right now. Though, they do rise to epipelagic depth on occasion. They're close relatives of the oarfish, one of my favorites. And here we have a school of Japanese jack mackerel. Now, you might be wondering, what's the difference between a shoal of fish and a school of fish? Well, a shoal is any group of fish that stay together for social reasons. But a school is any shoal that is swimming in the same direction in a coordinated manner. So when they're in a tight formation like that, they are schooling. Now we're still looking for that Japanese bullhead shark. These don't look to be that, but perhaps it's nearby. We have a striped marlin? And a very close relative. One that's a bit forthcoming. The Indo-Pacific sailfish. Now, you might be wondering, why are marlins called marlins? Well, they're named after the sailor's marlin spike. Basically a tool used in rope work tasks like unlaying rope, splicing, and untying knots. Looks quite similar to their beak-like noses. Now, you might notice that when we first found the Deep Valley, we got a little musical intro and cinematic. But here, at Between Heaven and Earth, we didn't have one. Some areas are just more significant than others. Though even areas like this have their own unique animals that show up, and special features. I love the scientific name for this fish. It's very pretty. Now we're starting to get outside the range, which means we're probably getting pretty far away from where that Japanese bullhead shark is supposed to be spawning. So we probably should be heading back towards our boat. It's more likely to be around there. Wait a minute. I think I see something special down here. Ooh. Now this is something a little different from other stuff we've seen thus far. Ah. The common octopus. Octopus vulgaris, also known as the common octopus, is the most well-known and studied of the octopus species. Octopi are cephalopod mollusks, with one pair of eyes and four pairs of arms. They have no internal or external skeleton, just a hard beak and on some species some remnant of their shell inside their body. This lack of support structure makes them very physically flexible. Even incredibly large specimens can fit through extremely small spaces. Octopi hatch from huge masses of 100,000 to 500,000 rice grain sized eggs, from which they live in the ocean currents for 60 days as plankton. Those that survive the time then develop large enough to live on the ocean floor, feeding on fish and other mollusks. The common octopus can grow to have a 25 centimeter long mantle, with arms of up to 1 meter in length. The largest species of octopus is most likely the North Pacific giant octopus, which can have an arm length of over 4 meters. The smallest octopus species is probably Octopus wolfii, which grows to a maximum size of around 1.5 centimeters in length overall. The common octopus only lives around 12 to 14 months. This is rather remarkable in itself, as cephalopods are actually incredibly intelligent. They are by far the most intelligent of the mollusks, if not among some of the most intelligent animals, period. Octopi are cunning and creative. Crabs are a common food source for octopi in general, which can be a difficult prey given their powerful claws and durability. So how do octopi cope? Well, sometimes they'll seek out lobster traps and take the easy and restrained game inside. They're even known to climb aboard fishing boats and sneak into containers holding dead or dying crabs. Much easier game, to be sure. Their arms, covered in highly sensitive suction cups, give them great dexterity combined with their flexible structure, allowing them to easily manipulate objects and tools. Their nervous system isn't heavily centralized like our own. Much of it is spread apart in the arms, allowing them to perform complex actions naturally and fluidly. By using their dexterity with their creative minds, they can do complex things like learn to unscrew jars, and even use rudimentary tools. They're the only invertebrate ever conclusively shown to use tools. The veined octopus will retrieve discarded coconut shells, transport them some distance, and then reassemble them later as shelter. Octopi are intelligent enough that they seemingly get bored if they lack stimulation. There's reports out of an aquarium in Coburg, Germany, of an octopus named Otto that will juggle its tank mates, throw rocks to break aquarium glass, and even spray water at overhead lamps and cause short circuits. Octopi are notorious in general for being hard to keep in aquariums, as they are excellent escape artists due to their flexibility and creativity. Octopi are also incredible in their control of color change cells, chromatophores. These cells are connected directly to their nervous system, allowing them to camouflage themselves nearly flawlessly. Their relatives, the squid, can use their chromatophores to even communicate with each other using patterns and color flashing in courtship rituals and basic communication. Now, the octopus in this game will mostly swim in place, though occasionally you'll see them extend their tentacles and do some more different things. Though not often. So what do we have here? Elegant firefish are actually a member of the dartfishes, the family Pteroleotridae. They're called dartfish because they have a tendency to go and dart in holes when they're frightened. How shocking. Now where the hell is Skippy? He's supposed to be helping us with this shit. Where is that dolphin? He shouldn't be too far away. The hell is he? Well? Huh. Guess we're going alone. Well, let's reorientate ourselves back towards G5. See if we can find these Japanese bullhead sharks. Shouldn't be too hard. They said that they were spawning and kind of swarming the area, so assume that they're probably somewhere near the bottom. Though I could be wrong about that. Is that one there? No, it's just another zebra. Shouldn't look too different from that, though. It's another low bottom feeding shark. Now, you might be wondering, why the hell is Skippy not coming to us? Why is he being a dick? Well, we're not really that close to him right now. We kind of helped him out of that lagoon, did some tricks with him, but that's really it. We don't have a really strong rapport with him right now. So unless we're close, he probably won't come. Who knows what the hell he's doing right now? We could die down here, and he wouldn't even know. How morbid. Now, I mentioned when talking about the different zones of the ocean, the risk of various diving sicknesses. And I wasn't entirely thorough with that. In fact, I was a bit too reductionary. I mentioned decompression sickness and the issues with nitrogen in your blood, but I wasn't really clear about exactly what happens. Well, when you breathe in compressed gas at a higher pressure than the surrounding water, your body tissues absorb nitrogen from the gas in proportion to the pressure around you. There is no problems while you're at a constant pressure, but if the pressure is reduced too quickly due to too rapid ascents, the nitrogen is isolated and forms bubbles in your tissues and bloodstream. These bubbles can cause all sorts of problems around your body. They can form in your muscles and joints and cause you excruciating pain. They can form beneath your skin and cause skin damage and lots of unpleasant feelings. They can form in your brain and spinal cord, and potentially cause you to defecate yourself, become paralyzed, suffer crippling pain, and other lovely stuff like that. It can also kill you outright, by damaging your heart, giving you an arterial embolism, or by causing you lethal levels of nerve damage, though death is somewhat rare. Treatment for decompression sickness is usually exposure to pure oxygen, combined with them putting you inside a decompression chamber, which reapplies pressures so that the bubbles will dissipate. So while diving, you really need to make sure to check your tables, and make sure you take decompression stops if you dive deep or frequently. Diving requires quite a bit of math and planning in order for you to stay safe. Now what's this doofy jerk right here? Flounders, also known as flatfish, are ray-finned fish of the order Pleuronectiforms, a common game fish, with their largest member, the halibut, being oft-fished. Their most notable feature is a metamorphosis that occurs uniquely to their order. When they are born, they look similar to the perch-like fish of the Perciforms. But as they age, their bodies change. Their eyes move to one side, and they begin to swim sideways. With their unique morphology, they become very capable camouflagers, hiding flush on the ocean floor. If we want to be a little unscientific, we can also speculate on the reasons for it. Imagine the proto-flatfish. They're a typical bony fish which tend to be vertically flat. If and when this hypothetical ancestral flounder began to try to hide itself upon the ocean floor, one of its eyes was made fundamentally useless, ever looking at the ground. Natural selection over time led to that eye moving around to the up-orientated side, resulting in the fish we have today. 50-million-year-old fossils showing intermediate species of this development have been discovered, showing primitive full-grown flounders with eyes on both sides of their head. Fascinating, isn't it? Bet you didn't see that one coming. Now, where is this Japanese bullhead shark? We found the scalloped hammerhead, which is totally unrelated. Here's another one right here. But where is that bullhead? We should be right in the middle of G5, where they said it's spawning. But I'm not really seeing it. Are we just missing it? It's entirely possible that we're just passing it up, but it should be a sandy bottom shark. Wait a minute. What have we here? And is it it? Let's see. Expectation? Excitement? Yes. The Japanese bullhead shark. We found it, guys. Good job. No thanks to Skippy. And what do we have here? A little bonus. Yep. Let's see if I can actually get it. Yep. Come on. Come on. Stop hiding in the hole. Come on. This is getting stupid. Just give us her name. Okay, we'll try food. No. He doesn't want the food. Huh. Well? Huh. Let's try this one. Nope. That didn't work at all either. Maybe it's like whack-a-mole? Maybe I need to pet them all into holes? I don't know. They seem a bit sheepish. Maybe I should try feeding them when they're outside the hole. Oh, that seemed to work. The spotted garden eel. I rather like eels. They're very different fish. I think that about wraps up our dive today. We successfully found the Japanese bullhead shark. We saw a lot of cool fish. Still have no idea where Skippy is, but, you know, we did what we came here to do. Next time, we have an encounter of rather gargantuan proportions. See ya.
This is the most smallest octopus I've seen in my life! I'd like to see what would happen if I giving to that octopus a little bit of
Viagra.
Maybe it growing perfectly.